This telecast is available in high definition. Brought to you by Pioneer's new Kuro.
Disappointing season for West Virginia. The one thing the Mountaineers have not done is drop a game at home. Defending home turf tonight in Morgantown against Auburn out of the SEC. And in front of this frenzied crowd, the Tigers might have the Mountaineers right where they want them. Nobody has been much better on the road than Auburn over the last 5 years. The third best record in the nation away from home. They've had wins in the swamp between the hedges and Bryant Denny, and they test Morgantown Magic tonight. Let's go down on the field here and join Aaron Andrews.
Reese, thanks so much. Coach, big night tonight, obviously, for Pat White going up against a school from his home state, but also his first game back from that concussion. What can we expect from him tonight?
He's just going to play within the framework of our offense and do what he can do, and that's just don't stay on course and move those chains. That's all we ask him to do.
Speaking of that offense, you told us yesterday they need to play with poise under pressure. How do they do that against a physical and powerful Auburn defense?
You just hold your water, you stay on side, you play aggressive but fair legal football, the Mountaineer football. We'll batter them down. We got to pound the rock and get after them.
All right, Coach, thank you so much.
You thank you.
Sure, Reese, back up to you.
All right, Aaron. Bill Stewart, intense, said he knew how to fight a bully yesterday, knew the SEC team would come in here and try to intimidate his squad. And as mentioned a moment ago, Tommy Tuberville's teams have just been outstanding away from home. Tuberville in his 10th season as a head coach on the Plains, 84-36, and he's had a sparkling record against non-conference opponents. A lot of turmoil this year for Tuberville's Tigers, but they'll try to get things turned around tonight against West Virginia. West Virginia won the toss, and they will receive. And getting set to kick it away for Auburn will be West Byram. The kicker and deep to receive for West Virginia will be Ellis Langster and Mark Rogers. Langster from the state of Alabama. This, like it is to Pat White, an important game to him. And we are underway. Ball is going to drive Rogers back and go out of bounds just before it reaches the goal line. So West Virginia will start in very good field position for Pat White and the West Virginia offense. Now, White has had a sparkling career. He is the two-time reigning Big East Player of the Year. He owns 16 West Virginia and Big East records. He is from Daphne, Alabama. It's a little less than 250 miles away from Auburn, but never really considered going to either Auburn or Alabama. And told us yesterday his home is in West Virginia, although they continue to honor him in Alabama. He's also the two-time reigning Amateur Athlete of the Year in the state of Alabama after having a storied high school career there. So West Virginia will put it in play. First snap from scrimmage coming from the 40-yard line. Mountaineers lined up in their customary spread. It is Noel Devine, the explosive running back, in the backfield with White. White's going to throw it on first down, and he's got to complete for a short gain. Ulrich Arnett making the first catch. No, the ball popped loose. It'll be incomplete. And second down, Walter McFadden there on the coverage. The impact players on offense for West Virginia, Noel Devine, 6 career 100-yard rushing games. He's an explosive sophomore, had a 92-yard touchdown against Syracuse. Jock Sanders is a guy who'll play in the backfield and at wide receiver, and Ryan Stanchek's going to have his hands full with that talented and quick defensive line of Auburn. He got All-America honors last year, did Stanchek. So a second and 10 after Arnett. Did not hold on to the first down pass from White. White to throw it again. Devine has it this time, and Devine's got running room into Auburn territory, and he'll be knocked down at about the 47 for a pickup of 13. Craig Stevens there to make the stop for the Tigers.
One thing about this West Virginia offense, when they spread you out, they like to get the ball in Noel Devine's hands, whether it be through a pitch or a run or dropping the ball to him, because in open space, he's extremely dangerous, extremely fast. He runs a 4-3, 40-yard dash.
Two plays, two passes so far. Now, White started the season, the opening week against Villanova, with 5 touchdown passes, but since then the passing game has slowed down for the Mountaineers, ranked 112th in the nation, averaging about 117 yards per game. Keep it on the ground this time, and Devine's got it. Devine's going to run sideways, and oftentimes that's not particularly a good idea against Auburn.
No, sometimes you get a big play when you do that, but when you bounce it outside all the time, you also lose yardage, and that has been very detrimental to West Virginia's offense. That's something that bothers the coaches.
West Virginia offensive coordinator Jeff Mullen telling us yesterday he wanted to establish some tempo. You're going to see a lot of this hard count, trying to get Auburn defensive coordinator Paul Rhodes to tip his hand about how many he's going to rush, where the blitz, if it's coming, where it might be coming from. Play clock inside 10. Second and 12 for White. Run the zone read. White's got it. White inside Auburn territory. Pat White stumbling over his own man, but he has the first down. Gerard Powers very well might have saved a touchdown with a bit of an assist from Arnett downfield, the West Virginia receiver. 22 yards on the play.
And an outstanding job by the offensive line of blocking right here in the middle. Keep an eye on him. Pat White's going to take this ball to the right. Right here, look at the hole, cut it back to the left. Get some great blocking down the field. But the key is his vision. He runs into his old man. If he picks up that block, he's gone for a score.
Will Johnson has joined Devine in the backfield. Looked as if Auburn's Merrill Johnson thought he had a little support on the inside, and White darted right by him and picked up 22. West Virginia with its opening possession on the move, and White's going to throw it again. This is Jock Sanders. Sanders slipping inside McFadden, and McFadden holding on for dear life. And Sanders gets inside the 20-yard line.
Coach, one thing is obvious. In this first drive, it looks like West Virginia's offense is in sync again, running the ball, throwing the ball.
Well, you know, Paul Rhodes had all the answers last year when he was at Pitt. But what happens is the offense gets a chance to study. And as we talked about today, West Virginia would make some great adjustments. They've done it already in the first drive.
Again, looking at the sideline to see what the checks are, because West Virginia goes no huddle. Not really up against the play clock. Experienced quarterback helps in that regard as well. White wants to throw again. He's got it complete. He's got Sanders again. It's a first down for the Mountaineers. They'll mark him out of bounds at the 12-yard line. Merrill Johnson there on the stop, and West Virginia is moving with great efficiency.
But just one thing they worked on, Pat White's mechanic, throwing the football. Jeff Mullen, the new offensive coordinator, here, rolls to the right, throws the ball extremely accurately right on the money.
Well, he is completing over 73% of the passes. And, you know, Colt McCoy's at 80, and that's an all-time record. He is playing exceptionally well at quarterback, Pat White.
Rhodes' defense has not allowed a first-quarter touchdown this year, but they're in a little bit of danger right now. They fake the end around. Oh, White throws it, and it's picked off. Josh Bynes right in the middle. The middle linebacker makes the interception and snuffs out the drive.
And Reese, this is an ill-advised pass, obviously, by quarterback Pat White. He's got his back to the defense where he can't see. He spins around, throws the ball. He doesn't have a chance to be patient on his play. He fakes the reverse, turns, throws the football right there. He should see that white jersey with his vision. He doesn't, Coach, and that's a terrific play by the Auburn defense of reading the
screen. Boy, it's just a great read by the defensive player. Outstanding.
Bynes, who stepped in for the injured Trey Blackman, has huge upside and has really matured as the leader of that Auburn defense. So Cody Burns, first play from scrimmage. Brad Lester's going to get it, and not much doing over the right side for the Auburn running back. Burns has the job full time now as the Tigers quarterback. He's a 6'1 sophomore from Fort Smith, Arkansas. And Burns has struggled to throw the football, completing just over 40% of his passes. In the early part of the season, he and Chris Todd were sharing time. Burns saying that his mindset now totally different now that he's not looking over his shoulder, has the opportunity to know that this is his team. Two back set for Auburn, who started the year as a spread team, and the football is on the ground. Lester put it down, and Auburn has had trouble with fumbles this year, and they're going to unpile it. Let's see. Let's see exactly who can. Looks like Auburn is going to retain possession, and Lester, who's had a couple of costly fumbles this season, guys, put it down again.
That's terrific hustle by Jason Balsey, the right tackle, getting downfield, getting on that ball. That ball's on the ground. You've got to hustle downfield as an offensive lineman and protect your back, get the football.
But when you're running to the left, you carry the ball in your left hand. When you're running to the right, you carry it in your right hand. He did just the opposite, which created the fumble.
Third down for Auburn. They're converting only 29% on the season, one of the worst in the nation, but they convert that one as Lester squirts ahead over the 30-yard line. We've seen a lot of Brad Lester. He will share some of the running duty tonight with Ben Tate. Both of those guys will get plenty of carries. Tate is a bruising runner on the inside. Robert Dunn, a little bit nicked up. He is dangerous in special teams, and assuming we see him, he'll have a huge impact. And Tommy Trott, the tight end, a guy that Auburn really wants to get the ball to more, and maybe a guy who will be a little bit of a safety valve to let Burns make some easy throws. Lester and Tristan Davis are out, and Trott is flexed a little bit to the left, and Lester got it, and he didn't go anywhere. There to greet him was JT Thomas.
We talked about going into this game, you cannot pound a 3-3-5 defense, which West Virginia runs, because they're going to create too many bad plays for you. It isn't a case of being physical, Mark. It's a case of being able to get ahead on all the defensive players.
Coach, I believe a 3-3-5, you've got to attack it like a 34 defense. You have to zone block up front, take the proper steps and hat placement, and take away every gap from the defense.
Burns now going to throw it, and he's throwing for Tim Hawthorne, and Hawthorne got his hands underneath and makes the catch at about the 37-yard line, though the freshman Robert Sands was on the coverage. I did not believe that Hawthorne made the catch. Officials say that he did indeed. Burns, a confident throw, gets it out to Hawthorne nicely.
I don't know about that one.
They better snap the ball in a hurry. A third down play for Burns. And they do get it away. Burns going to throw it right over the middle, and there's Trott. Tommy Trott getting up close to midfield and struggling and nudging his way into West Virginia territory. The big tight end with his first catch of the night.
This is a very nice play, a catch in West Virginia in a blitz and ran low tight end delay. You're going to see a replay here. The tight end just sort of sits there, then comes off.
Nice job by quarterback Cody Burns. He was backpedaling when he threw that ball, had that little hop step to deliver that ball. Almost looked like a mini Tebow hop.
And how about these two offenses, both of whom have struggled to varying degrees this year, both with impressive opening drives. West Virginia's ended in a turnover. Auburn has picked up a first down. Mario Fannin in the backfield getting a carry. He, too, will play a little bit of receiver, a little bit of running back. And calling the plays for the Tigers tonight is Steve Insminger, the former LSU quarterback and also former offensive coordinator at Clemson and Texas A&M. He has assumed that position on an interim basis after the dismissal of Tony Franklin, the bizarre situation that happened midweek before the Arkansas game. Franklin talked with Al Pat Forty. We'll detail that conversation and stories as the night goes on. Burns getting all kinds of heat in the backfield, just had to get rid of it. Applying the pressure was Quentin Andrews, the junior from Opelika, Florida.
It's a terrific job of Andrews staying with his read and his keys and going to the quarterback, first contain, coach, and then going right for quarterback Cody Burns.
I cannot understand why this baby wasn't called intentional grounding. He's number one. He's not outside the tackle box. There's no receiver close, nor does the ball cross the line of scrimmage. All the ingredients necessary to throw the ball away without a penalty.
Burns has hit two of his first three passes, but now he needs a third down conversion. He needs nine. Burns pulling it down and running with it. Burns slips a tackle. Cody Burns has the first down close to the 35-yard line.
Quarterback Cody Burns doing a little Pat White imitation on that run. That was a terrific job of looking downfield and finding a way to pick up the first down. It looked like he was stopped short of the first down, but you see he's got tremendous vision, coach. The 205 pounds picks up a block there, but look at him. He needs to protect the ball a little bit better, but nice job.
Very good coverage by West Virginia. Cody Burns had nobody open.
Davis and Fannin are the running backs as Auburn returns to the I formation. Tigers, with the hiring of former offensive coordinator Tony Franklin, had it in mind to go to be a true spread team. They're going back to the basics, old school Auburn football and running it downhill, and it's effective with Fannin as he's going to pick up about four and get close to the 30-yard line before he is stopped by Chris Neal. Now, offensive productivity has not been great for Auburn over the last few years under former offensive coordinator Al Borges. And last year, before the Chick-fil-A Bowl, Tuberville decided he wanted to try to spice things up, enhance recruiting a little bit, and maybe open up the offense some. He hired Tony Franklin, and it really hasn't worked up to this point in the season, and hence they've made another change midseason. Then carrying the ball is Fannin, who's gaining a lot of time. He's close to the first down mark. It's going to be probably about a yard short.
Well, you showed those statistics, and you said they hired Tony Franklin. It didn't work out. It would have been better if they brought back Cadillac Williams and Brown and all those great backs and players they had, but those statistics were better.
2004 with Jason Campbell at quarterback. It tends to make a lot of offenses go. Tigers have struggled on third down this season, but they've been perfect so far tonight. 3 for 3. They've got another opportunity here. Fannin. Fannin keeping the feet moving, but cannot pick up the first down. The ball was not free, but I believe you can see his progress was stopped before the ball came loose. And that ball is right on that yellow line, which is remarkably accurate. And it looks like it's going to be just a little over a nose short, although Cody Burns has not disagreed. It depends on the accuracy of the yellow line and the Blues' eyes.
I'll tell you, if Cody Burns can see that that's a first down, already signaling it, he has great eyesight. He should never throw an interception.
Well, he's got great eyesight, Coach.
Certainly does.
I think he does.
First down.
That's pretty good call by Cody.
By the nose of the football, and Tuberville's team 4 for 4 on third down, controlling the ball, keeping Pat White off the field and on the march at the 25-yard line. Now back to more of a spread look with Lester in the backfield alongside Burns. Lester's got it. Brad Lester takes a couple of big hits as he gets inside the 25-yard line, but another positive play on the ground for the Tigers.
So far, watching quarterback Cody Burns, I've been impressed with how he's handled this drive. Not only that, when he has to audible the ball, he'll make sure that he goes up to the line of scrimmage, making sure the right side of the offensive line, the left side of the offensive line, the tight ends, they know the play, they know the snap count, so there's no mistakes on the play even before it starts.
Lester in the backfield on a 2nd-and-8 play. Lester cutting it back. Brad Lester with a strong run down to the 15. He's got another Auburn first down. Anthony Leonard makes the stop. Terrific run by Lester.
We're going to say replay. Do not minimize the importance of an open date when you're struggling, whether it be offensively or defensively. You go back to basics. The offensive line is playing exceptionally well, and that has been a problem this year.
Coach, not only that, look at the blocks down the field to play, getting to the second level by the offensive line. That was key for that play to have success.
With Mike Berry, who moved from tackle to guard, playing right guard, pulling around and getting a good block. This is the 15th play of the Auburn drive. This one barely going to nudge inside the 15. It was Lester again, and it was Leonard making the stop.
But Auburn's had tremendous difficulty in the red zone this year. One of the poorest teams in the entire country.
60% scoring, only 10 touchdowns in 25 possessions. Do you know who the worst team in the red zone is?
The one that has a good field goal kicker, because if you don't have a good field goal kicker, you go for it on fourth down.
Well, they're second worst in Notre Dame.
Well, they score from way out.
Fannin back in the backfield. Mario Fannin has it again. Fannin finds a little crease. Mario Fannin inside the 5-yard line. Quentin Andrews makes the stop, but this Auburn offense on the move, and there goes Mike Berry again with a good block to spring Fannin.
What a great job. This is so well defended, but notice as he's coming out here, he stretches it, he waits for them to overrun, and then he's going to cut it back up underneath.
That's a terrific job of hat placement by the lineman, stretching it on a stretch play like that. Make sure you get a body on a body and let the back plant and make his cut.
Great patience.
Fannin trying it again. He'll pick up about one. It'll bring up 2nd and goal.
This first quarter shows you how much I know. It's going to be a great defensive game. West Virginia drive starts a big drive. I mean, it's unbelievable.
This Auburn offense controlling the clock, started on its own 17. They've run 17 plays, moved 81 yards, eaten up over half of the first quarter, and now an opportunity on second and goal. Lester back in at running back. Lester's got it. Lester leaping, and he'll be stopped short of the goal line. Linesman coming in and marking him about a step outside the one. It'll bring up third and goal.
West Virginia has done a nice job, but Auburn's had problems, Bart, on third down. The reason it's always been third and seven. Almost every third down has been third or one, third and two, which is why they've been up to be successful.
Well, right now, the way Tommy Tuberville's calling this game, particularly down getting close to the goal line, he's lining up and just hammering the ball. Not getting cute, not getting fancy. He's got to live with his bread and butter. The run got us down here, and we're going to continue to do it.
Third and goal is the Tigers. Try to strike first. Again, a little combination, a little mix-up in the backfield. Fannin leaped, and he didn't get there. The West Virginia defense rising up. Pat Lazier was in the game on the tackle. Got some help from Ellis Langster. And Auburn sends the field goal unit onto the field after losing a yard.
Now, this is just poor execution by the offense. Bad footwork by the quarterback and back. And luckily, they didn't fumble the ball on that play.
As a coach, you tell the offensive line, please allow him to get to the line of scrimmage untouched. If he gets to the line of scrimmage untouched, he's 6 foot tall. He's going to fall forward for 2 yards. But they got to get him to the line of scrimmage untouched.
Coach, what if he's 5'11"?
Well, they do need them to get quite 2 yards.
Wes Byram trying to put the Tigers on the board first. And Byram, who had a sensational year as a freshman last year, has struggled at times this year. But he is true on that one. A 20-play drive covering 81 yards for the Tigers. Results in a field goal. Both offenses have moved early, and Auburn's up 3-0. Welcome back to Morgantown. All of that talk of struggling offenses rendered moot. Auburn only got a field goal out of its drive, but they strike first against West Virginia. But it was a methodical march, 20 plays. They ate up nearly 10 minutes of the clock, last 11 of the 20 plays. Auburn moved it on the ground. That's Byram kicking it off for the second time tonight, and it is Ellis Langster, the native of the state of Alabama, returning it, and he gets up across the 30-yard line, close to the 33. Mike McNeil on the stop. West Virginia moved early. White threw an interception to stop their first drive. The Mountaineers have it for the second time when you come back.
ESPN's College Football Primetime is presented by Applebee's. It's a whole new neighborhood. And in part by Bud Light. The difference is drinkability.
Taking a little ride with the personal rapid transit system on the West Virginia campus. In fact, it connects all three campuses and has done so for more than 30 years. Students can avoid the parking hassles because all of them can't have a policeman drive them in the way Lou Holtz can. Just whip them right through the traffic.
We just encouraged them.
Second possession of the night for West Virginia. The first one ended in Pat White's second interception of the season. Two backs with him now switching sides are Sanders and Noel Devine. White going to throw it again. Arnett has it, and Arnett slammed to the ground by Tez Doolittle. Let's check in with Aaron Andrews, Aaron.
Well, Reese, as we've mentioned throughout the night, Pat White, his first game back since suffering that concussion against Rutgers. He missed West Virginia's last game against Syracuse. Now, that concussion, his third ever in his career, and he said it was the worst he's ever had. He actually forgot the entire game, and that is why tonight he says he looks like an alien. He's wearing a new helmet called the Shut Ion, and what it does is has more cushioning in it, Reese, particularly more in the temple area where he got hit in that Rutgers game, and the chin strap held very tight, so obviously it gives the jaw some protection there.
Aaron, those helmets supposed to deflect some of the impact as well, but and again, White is picked off. Walter McFadden with the pick. and McFadden's inside the West Virginia 30-yard line, and Pat White's thrown a couple of picks against his home state team, and the Tigers in business again inside the Mountaineer 30.
This is a terrific job by Walter McFadden of reading the eyes of quarterback Pat White. He's got him zeroed in. Pat White doesn't look anyone off on this, coach. He's zeroed in on his receiver right here. Look at him. Look at his head. Right there down the middle. He knows where he wants to force the ball. But a terrific job by McFadden.
The question I asked is, why are they throwing the ball so much when Pat White has run for, what, 30 yards on one attempt? He's not a great passer. He is a runner, but that's a decision Coach Story's made, and I can't second-guess it, other than the fact that behind 3-0.
White on the phone upstairs with Jeff Mullen, the offensive coordinator. Meanwhile, Auburn trying to cash in on the second turnover of the first quarter. Eric Smith, the freshman, in the backfield for the Tigers now, and Auburn will keep it on the ground with its quarterback, Burns, dashing inside the 25 and picking his way very nicely. We're getting a great college football weekend kicked off tonight here in Morgantown, but Saturday night, ESPN, ESPN2, have a couple of primetime games. 7:45 Eastern time, number 2, Alabama, traveling to Rocky Top to face a Volunteer team, is struggling much like the two we're seeing here tonight. And Washington is the epitome of struggling. Former Notre Dame coach Tyrone Willingham against Charlie Weiss and the Fighting Irish. That's on ESPN2. Well, it has been stopped after the Burns run for about 6. That brought up a 2nd and 4. We're inside a minute to go in the first quarter. It's Penn Wagers from the Southeastern Conference, the visiting team, bringing the officials.
I think the problem was you cannot have a towel in front of you except a certain length. West Virginia had a couple of them too long and you had to remove them.
And he threw one toward the West Virginia sideline and sitting out on the field at about the 13-yard line on Auburn's left-handed offensive side. Now this a holdover from the Tony Franklin system to look to the sideline and the hard count to try to get 3-3-5 of West Virginia to tip its hand. Burns going to run it again. Cody Burns has enough for the first down as he gets down close to the 15-yard line. Quentin Andrews there to make the stop.
And it's a difficult job by the defense to stop a running quarterback because you get that extra blocker in there, coach, and it puts a lot of pressure on your safeties to come up and fill when that quarterback runs the ball, particularly if you're a physical guy over 200 pounds.
It's nothing more than the single wing and power attack didn't do very well executed.
And Auburn is executing beautifully for Tommy Tuberville on offense so far. West Virginia's done a good job this season taking care of the football, but not in the first quarter. The Tiger defense forces a couple of turnovers, and Auburn threatening to get more. Second quarter around the corner. Lights of Milan Pushkar Stadium have become a normal sight on Thursday nights in Morgantown, West Virginia, trailing Auburn 3-0. And Bill Stewart telling us yesterday he knew a team from the SEC would come here and try to intimidate. And right now, Auburn's doing just that with its offensive line. They've run 13 straight running plays, trying to take advantage of a second West Virginia turnover tonight. Eric Smith, the freshman, has it. Smith cutting back into traffic. The 232-pounder slams it down close to the 10-yard line.
Mark, my experience, players in the offensive line love this type of game. They want to run the ball. They want to be physical. You've been offensive line. Is this type of game you like?
Absolutely. Smash mouth football. Just line up and knock them back off the ball. And what happens if you do that for a couple of quarters, it wears the defensive lineman down, so you own them in the second half and in the fourth quarter.
15 straight runs. It's Smith again. It's Smith finding tough sledding as the West Virginia defense is there en masse, led by Anthony Leonard and Morty Ivy, the senior.
When you play a physical game up front, the players just get involved and they really get a pride in the fact they're controlling the line of scrimmage. But I got to say this, West Virginia's tackled very well. I've been impressed with how well both teams have tackled.
Robert Dunn into the game. Auburn has three receivers to the left. Smith, Dunn, and Trott over there, and Burns. He's thrown it 3 times against 20 running plays. Might have to go to the air. He might need to hurry and get the snap as the play clock is winding down. I don't think he got it off, and Auburn's going to move it back 5.
That is the first penalty.
Dead ball, delay of game on the offense. Penalty 5 yards. Down remains third.
The first penalty of the game. That's unbelievable, Mark. This long into a game before your first penalty.
Well, he's done an outstanding job of playing a clean football game. But when I look at this, when you've got an offense like this and you continue to look to the sidelines before you can make a decision, Tommy Tuberville's upset about this because he knew he had them exactly where he wanted them. Stop looking to the sidelines. Get up there and run the play.
But the coach could call timeout, too. You see it, you call it.
Tuberville frustrated. Now Burns going to try to convert. They've got a screen set up with Lester. Lester's got a blocker in front. Brad Lester into the end zone. Touchdown, Auburn. Tyrone Green leads Zimba, leading the way on third and 10. 16 yards for the touchdown, and Auburn's up 9-0.
Reese, this is a terrific job of the offensive line getting out, getting their blocks in space, and staying on the defender, allowing your back, Brad Lester, to go straight down the field and use his speed and power and run the ball downfield.
Burns with his first touchdown pass of the year, and Auburn has come into Morgantown and jumped on top of Bill Stewart and the Mountaineers and taken a little bit of air out of the stadium. Pat White will try to rally his troops, but right now it's Lester and the Tigers in that big offensive line that's dominating. Airlines on ABC. That ought to be a dandy. Obvious national championship implications, particularly for the Nittany Lions. You never know. Obviously, we see the upsets every week, but that would appear to be the lone remaining obstacle in Penn State's path, at least the lone remaining major obstacle in their path. A couple of Pat White turnovers set up Auburn for 10 points, and West Virginia has the kickoff on the ground, but it is corralled easily by Mark Rogers, and Rogers will be horse collared and brought down at about the 26-yard line. Pleased to be joined now on the field by head basketball coach at West Virginia, Bob Huggins. Bob, I know you've got a terrific freshman class coming in. I remember last year when you were picked 10th in the Big East, you said you never coached a team that finished 10th. Are you going to coach a team that finished 9th? That's where they pick you this time.
I hope not, Reese. You know, our league's so good that you never know, but I sure hope not.
You got a freshman, Devin Ebanks. How's he played for you so far?
Well, you know, we got three freshmen and a Judico guy, and they're all running into each other right now. You know, they're trying to figure it out. It's hard to play and think, but they're talented guys. We said that whole group's going to be really good Big East players.
Pretty good Big East running back just got loose. Noel Devine rips off 36, and the Mountaineers on the move again inside the 35-yard line of Auburn.
This is the same play where Pat White went for 20, but this time he pitched the ball in the option.
Bob, we'll get back to Bob Huggins in just a moment. Devine noted for the big play, 92-yarder his last time out. Again, he'll give. And again, picking his way and picking out good yardage is Noel Devine as he gets inside the 20-yard line. And Zach Etheridge brings him down. And Bob, West Virginia now going back to a strong suit, sort of like finding a hot score and going back to what you know will work, I guess. Bob, what do you... West Virginia has had to change its offense a little bit in football this year. You had a similar situation in basketball. Players who were not necessarily suited for the system that you'd run historically. What's that like for a coach?
They were great, Reese. They embraced it. You know, we give them a lot of freedom, and they really enjoyed the freedom. And you know, they were really enthusiastic in practice and worked really hard at it. And you know, John did a great job with them before, so their understanding of how to play was good to start with, and it was a fun bunch. You know, I think the challenge was probably a little bit more defensively than it was offensively.
West Virginia had a penalty tacked on against Auburn. It's got them down inside the 10-yard line with a first down, and White will look to the sideline again as West Virginia tries to answer quickly the Auburn touchdown following the second Pat White interception. Play clock now down inside 10. Noel Devine has been the guy who's done the work for West Virginia on the way down. White just gets it off. White going to the end zone for Arnett. It's just out of his hands. Walter McFadden, who had the interception, was on the coverage against Arnett. Now here is the play in which Devine was running in the penalty that ended up tacking some yardage on. It was the horse collar penalty.
Well, the horse collar and face mask combination.
And now a second down and goal to goal for the Mountaineers. They try to answer the strong first quarter from the Tigers and have them on top 10-0. White. Little move. White inside the 5-yard line. He's knocked down by Craig Stevens. It'll bring up third and goal. All right, Bob, the Big East is going to be as good in basketball as you can imagine. How many teams realistically do you think could make the NCAA tournament?
I can see 10 easily. You know, when you got four in the top preseason top 10 and seven in the top 25, I mean, 10 is, I think, very realistic.
Well, Bob, we wish you all the luck in the world, and thanks for spending some time with us. Enjoy the game tonight.
Well, the way we're moving the ball, Reese, I probably ought to stay on here.
I'm sure Bill Stewart would like for you to. Anything for a little good luck.
That's exactly right.
Posting coming back this way. White looking for running room, and Pat White is not going to find it. Auburn's defense standing strong. Antonio Coleman helping out on the tackle. And it'll bring up a fourth and goal. And just as West Virginia stopped Auburn on the doorstep once, now the Tiger defense has returned the favor. West Virginia will line up to kick a field goal.
And Coach, this is a fabulous job by Auburn's defense of getting penetration. Penetration always kills running plays.
Yeah, no doubt about it. I think you saw Coach Tuberville all bundled up there. He's a little bit warmer than he was through the first drive.
Pat McAfee, who has a great leg but often struggles with the shorter range field goals, puts one up, and it is true. And West Virginia is on the board. So a good answer from the Mountaineers after the Tigers hit them right in the mouth, and it's Auburn who will get the ball back up by 7. A beautiful, crisp fall evening here in Morgantown, West Virginia. Tommy Tuberville and Auburn on top of the Mountaineers by a count of 10-3. Now, Tommy, guys, nice and bundled up. This is the northernmost point that Auburn has played a game outside since the 1984 kickoff classic against Miami, and that was played at the beginning of the season, so it was nice and warm. You see, West Virginia, they're prepared for the elements.
Where's our heater? That's all I want to tell you. It's cold.
I mean, but that jacket's big enough. Tubbs probably has a heater built into that thing.
He isn't worried about the heat right now or the cold. What he's worried about, all three losses, they've had a 10-point lead. They had a 10-point lead, and you see West Virginia kick field goal. You go, oh, golly, here we go again.
Oh, you coaches need to toughen up. You have to set an example of toughness, mental toughness for players. Go out there in short sleeves.
Yeah. Shannon thought about it and decided to bring it out of the end zone. Good decision. Pass at 20, maybe a real good one. Mario Fannin going the other way. Only McAfee to beat, and he stumbles in. Auburn will have great field position at the 31-yard line after a scintillating kickoff return of 69 yards from Mario Fannin.
You're going to see a replay here coming on this, Mark, and you're going to just see how all of a sudden it breaks up right up in here. He comes here, they get off the block, he sees it. All you do is occupy people. You really don't have to block them.
You have to make sure you get your body and your numbers in front of them squarely so the return man can see those numbers so he can make those cuts. But that was a great job of opening up the hole and creating an alleyway for the return man.
And Auburn has returned a punt for a touchdown and a kickoff already this season.
First time they had done that in the same season since 1970, and they almost had another kickoff return for a score there. As it is, the offense in tremendous field position. A fake to Lester. Burns going to throw it on first down. He's got a man wide open. It's Davis. Tristan Davis catching the pass, and the Auburn offense is clicking. Ellis Langster on the stop. It'll be first and goal for the Tigers.
First and goal, Auburn.
On the replay, you're going to see he just comes out the backfield. Nobody picks him up, throws the ball here.
Coach, because Auburn's run the ball so successfully, look at those blue jerseys step towards the line of scrimmage on the fake. Because they know that they've been pounding the football, they have to respect the run.
That's why you run the football, then your big plays come off play action.
Auburn, little bootleg. Burns has it. Burns out running room. Is into the end zone. Touchdown, Tigers. On the feet leg, suckered Scooter Berry, and Auburn pushes the lead to 16-3.
Unbelievable. This is the Auburn offense that we have seen. Just good play action, sets up the play. Here he's going to come here, fake. They get caught in here. He also is a pass option run.
It's a terrific job of play calling and going down with this drive and finishing off in an open boot like that to take advantage of the defense.
Burns' third rushing touchdown in the air, and it took just a kick return and two plays for Auburn to push the lead from 10-3 to 17-3. Now that is an answer to the West Virginia drive. Cody Burns establishing himself as the Tiger leader, and he has Auburn up by 14.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Hummer, like nothing else, and Kingsford. Get your tailgate started right with Kingsford Charcoal from the Home Depot.
Little guy getting set for Halloween, and it's been all tricks and no treats so far for West Virginia tonight here at Milan Puskar Stadium in Morgantown as Auburn has come in and looked like an entirely different team. Hey, Bert, Ernie, here's your buddy. Sesame Street reference.
They didn't have Sesame Street when I grew up. They didn't even have television and barely had radio.
I'm glad you said that and took it away from Mark.
That was
a hanging curveball that Mark did. Here comes the onside kick, and it's executed beautifully by Wes Byram, and the Riverboat Gambler has reemerged.
But I was just watching the way West Virginia lined up, and Mark, I was thinking, wow, what an onside kick go. Notice, instead of having five men on the line, they only have four, and the middle guy is back. You can't sit back here. And what they do is they just grip it here. Nobody can touch him until it goes 10 yards, and the kicker picks it up.
But what a terrific opportunity to take advantage of West Virginia. Right now you have the momentum, and this place executed perfectly. The ball bounces exactly where they need it. They've got people protecting the kicker. He slides down the ball. Auburn contains the ball. They get the ball here, first down, great field position. Outstanding by Tommy Tubby.
Obviously, they had noticed something in the study of the tape. It was Courtney Stewart who bailed right out of there and left it wide open.
Well, it was obvious, but you have to have a lot of courage to call it. I would have called it.
Ben Tate into the game for the first time, and Auburn is now running a reverse. Open running room for the Tigers. Had a moment, and in just a moment, it closed up quickly. Let's check in now with Chris Fowler for SportsCenter right now.
Reese Grumbling in Morgantown, concern in New England. Tom Brady's had two additional procedures following knee surgery to clean out the infection there. And it's official. After 34 seasons as head basketball coach at Arizona, Lute Olson is retiring. SportsCenter after the game. You can stay current with ESPN News. Reese.
And Chris, an unusual situation with Arizona after Kevin O'Neill, at one time was the coach in waiting there, was dismissed. And after Montez Billings was dropped on the reverse, Burns drops back, hits Tate out of the backfield. Tate getting his first series of the night, and it's going to bring up third in about a mile and a half. Now, Coach, you look at this, and you pull off the onside kick, and you want to take advantage and really put the hammer down on West Virginia right now. But now you got a third and long, young quarterback. What are you calling here?
Oh, I would call a draw, because let's remember this. Auburn has only given up three rushing touchdowns this entire season. They're playing good defense. They're making things happen. You have good field position. Just play conservative. You don't need the great play to win. All you need to do is eliminate the bad one.
Third and 16. Tigers will keep it on the ground. It'll be Burns. Burns had running room for a moment, but he's not anywhere close to the first down. Sidney Glover, the sophomore from Warren, Ohio, making the tackle in Auburn. After executing the onside kick, we'll have to punt it away. We assume the Riverboat Gambler may be back.
No, he's not going to do it again. But the bottom line is, when you go back, they took the momentum away from West Virginia. They've had so much success pounding the football. Why didn't they just go back to that? They ran that reverse, and the reverse cost them a ton of yardage and put them in bad field position.
Seeing Clinton Durst punting the ball away for Auburn, there's Ellis Langster deep to receive. Prior to tonight, Auburn punters had more yards than the Auburn offense. The Auburn offense has changed all of that thus far in the first half, and Durst, who has a big leg, hits it down around the 20-yard line. Let's see where they're going to mark it out of bounds and where West Virginia will put it in play. It looks as if it'll be about the 22-yard line. Let's take a look at the ESPNU All-State Standings Review. These are the BCS standings. All fresh off the press and ready for another week of intrigue coming up. Texas and Alabama leading the way with Penn State right behind. Look at all of those ats. A bunch of ats that can shake up these stands.
A lot of teams down the road. Coach, I really can't argue with any of the teams that are placed there in the top 10. I think they got it about right because it's still early. There's a lot of football left.
A lot of football left. And that BCS is going to change a lot of times between now and the end of the season.
Saw it happen time and time again last year, even down to the final game here in Morgantown when the Mountaineers were just a victory over Pittsburgh away from playing in the national championship game. And Paul Rhodes, who's now the defensive coordinator at Auburn, brought his crew in from Pitt, Scott McKillop, and shut down the vaunted Mountaineer attack and knocked West Virginia out of the national championship game. Reese Davis, Lou Holtz, Mark May here with you on a Thursday night. Aaron Andrews working on the sideline. This Tiger offense, Mark, has been nothing like we've seen in the first seven games for them this year.
They've been outstanding, particularly up front with the offensive line, pounding the football, allowing quarterback Cody Burns to do whatever he wants to do, either run or throw the ball. But the backs going downhill, running the ball downhill, has been extremely impressive.
Quick sweep from Jock Sanders, and he'll pick up the first down, and a couple of costly turnovers, too, by Pat White throwing interceptions, which led to 10 Auburn points.
Well, it has, because West Virginia's basically not a throwing team. But let me say this. Auburn's gone back to being Auburn. Anybody has them on their schedule, they better button their head gear because they play physical football. This is what really made them solid.
White giving it away to Devine. Devine in the open field where he's so dangerous, and while he was looking for room, he got walloped from behind by Chris Evans, the outside linebacker who ran it down, but it's another big run for Devine. He picks up 20 in the first down.
Coach, one thing about this West Virginia offense, in order for them to pick up huge chunks of yardage and first downs, they can do it on the ground because of the speed of Noel Devine and Pat White.
They can. When you look for 4 yards, the 15, the 20-yarders will come. This is the same running back who last year averaged 8.8 yards per try. And West Virginia's lacking the big play this year. That's one of the biggest differences between this offense this year and last year.
Runs of 10 yards or more, down 16 from a similar point last year after six games. But tonight, they have had a couple of big plays on the ground. And West Virginia desperately needing to get on the board. They're down by 2 touchdowns to Auburn. Sprint Cup Series is going to hit Atlanta on Sunday. Jimmy Johnson trying to score his second straight win, put a little distance between himself and those chasing him in the chase for the Sprint Cup. Coverage begins with NASCAR Countdown at 1 Eastern on ABC from Atlanta on Sunday.
You know, Jimmy Johnson's had 3 victories at Atlanta. Prior to his 13th place finish in the spring, he had finishes of 6th, 2nd, 1st, and 1st. Coach, he owns the track.
The last time anybody finished 39 positions ahead of Johnson was at Charlotte earlier this year. Also, it's the last time Johnson blew a motor. It's the only blown engine the number 48 car has had since the fall 2005 race at Bristol. 116 races. You don't think I follow NASCAR?
How do you do it, Coach? Amazing.
Oh, I just marvel at myself.
White going deep. He's got a man. It's a touchdown, West Virginia. Ulrich Arnett and the Mountaineers answer.
Just a great throw, great play. Now, here's the amazing thing. Auburn is 45-0 when they score 30 points. West Virginia is 57-1 when they score 30. I didn't think there was any way anybody would score 30 tonight, Mark.
Well, it's a fabulous job by quarterback Pat White on this play to hang and stay with his receiver to the very end when he gets tattooed on the play. But for Auburn's defense, your safety help, you have to be deeper than the deepest, and they got beat in the back. Ulrich did an outstanding job. Ulrich Arnett used his speed and got behind the safeties.
Arnett, who was out fought for an interception by Walter McFadden earlier, atones with a touchdown catch. And West Virginia hanging in there. Took about 91 seconds, and Pat White, the senior who'd already thrown a couple of interceptions on the night, sets his feet and turns it loose with Goggins in his face. And Arnett gets the Mountaineers right back in it on a Thursday night in Morgantown. The lead is just 7. The kickoff from McAfee is going to drive Tristan Davis into the end zone. He's going to let it bounce, and Auburn will take over on his 20. And this is pretty much what everybody expected from this game.
Oh,
big plays,
yeah.
Back and forth, running up and down the field.
Lots of scoring.
Oh, yeah.
they changed the offense. Auburn did. They went back to a physical football game, and their offensive line has responded. Their backs have responded, and Cody Burns has looked excellent. But let's also give credit to West Virginia. That was a great, great answer to Auburn's touchdown.
Great play calling, but it was perfect execution by quarterback Pat White, delivering the ball exactly where it had to be under duress.
So the other thing it's done is pumped a little life into this crowd here in Morgantown. Auburn have flattened them out a little bit, and they're starting to rise up wearing their gold tonight. See if the defense can slow down this Auburn rushing attack. Lester tries the middle and picks up about three. Aaron Andrews, what do you have for us?
Reese, it appears the Mountaineers defense will be without their defensive end, Scooter Berry. Right now he's on the bench, visibly upset. He has ice on his right knee, and I haven't been able to get a hold of a trainer yet, but everybody's coming over to him, patting him on the back. It doesn't look good for him to come in, at least in this half, obviously.
All right, Aaron, that will certainly be a big loss for the Mountaineer defense. Berry's asserted himself as one of the stalwarts on the defensive line, and when he arrived here, he was really just part of a, I don't want to say afterthought, but almost a package deal with the ballyhooed running back Jason Gwaltney, his half-brother, and Gwaltney is now gone from the team and is putting his career back together at CW Post. Meanwhile, Berry, who's was an athletic fullback linebacker type when he arrived here, said he ate himself into the defensive line during his gray shirt time. And you see how upset he is. He was looking forward to this game, talked about how special it was for West Virginia to play on Thursday night. His defensive mates are out there now trying to keep Auburn from converting a third down, which has been most problematic for the old gold and blue tonight. Auburn 5-7 on third down. Burns trying to make it 6-8, and he will. Cody Burns dancing for the first down.
Reese, you just mentioned that Auburn's been 5-7 on third down. They've been outstanding to have that percentage of converting third downs. But right here, take a look at the fullback, Brad Lester, the running back. Gets a nice block downfield. That's what you have to have on successful running plays, guys getting down there making those extra blocks.
Ben Tate back in the game at running back. And 6-8 on third down. The quick math tells me that's 75%, which is nearly, not quite, but nearly three times the conversion rate that Auburn has had here in the season up to this point. And Tate, not much running room over the right side.
But West Virginia's also given up 45% on third down, which is very, very poor for defense. You compare that mark with Auburn, which is 22% on third down.
And Auburn's done a terrific job throughout the season of putting offenses in third and long, which means it's difficult to convert on third downs. But tonight, I like the way the Auburn offense is running the ball up front, putting the quarterback, Cody Burns, in great position on third down.
You're right. All Auburn's trying to do is play the game of football, which is get 10 yards. Go to that yellow stripe. Don't worry about anything else. Just get 10 yards and do it again. First and 10, do it again. Make a great cheer.
Oh, Coach, they can't see the yellow stripe.
I thought they painted it out there for them to help them. Burns complete again. He's thrown it well, making the grab on the outside is Derek Winter, the freshman from Tampa, Florida. Glover again on the stop.
What a great open field tackle that was. I mean, here you have a receiver in the open field, just perfect form, forcing the receiver to fall backwards.
Pickup of a couple is going to leave Burns staring at a third and six. He'll try for another conversion. We wind down toward 3.5 minutes to go in the first half. Auburn with the spread formation now. We've seen some two back. We've seen some spread. And here comes a little blitz. Burns going to throw it underneath to Trott. Trott has his second catch of the night. And Auburn has its seventh third down conversion.
This Auburn offense has been extremely efficient. What they did on that play, Coach, it's a quick pass by the quarterback. You chop the blitzers, you chop the defensive front to get those hands down and allowing Cody Burns to deliver the ball exactly where he wants to on third and five to get the first down.
Well, Steve Emslinger has really done a nice job, but this was a zone blitz that West Virginia ran, and Cody Burns did a great job, as you said, Mark, of recognizing it, and the soft spot on the zone blitz is an 8-yard hook.
Trott exploited that beautifully, as did Burns, and Auburn back in the two-back set, and Tate has it. Then Tate wrapped up. He'll get nothing. Ian Smith there, and a lot of Mountaineers joined him in very short order, including Brandon Hogan, who moved over from the offensive side during spring ball. And there is Smith, the freshman from Miramar, Florida, who's the first to get to Tate.
To disrupt this, type of offense, Bart. You either have to have the offense commit a foolish penalty to get him out of the rhythm, or you need a lost yardage play or a turnover.
Second and long. Mason Burns. Play clock again is on him, getting down toward five. Cody Burns on the throw. He's got a man at about the 50-yard line. It won't be enough for the first down, and making the grab is Quindarius Carr, the freshman from Huntsville, Alabama. Hogan there to make the stop.
Which I like Cody Burns, and he decides to make a decision to go with the football. There's no hesitation. It's a quick whip reaction with the arm, and the ball gets from A to B in a hurry.
But they are making it so simple. You read the corner, either throw it to the short guy or throw it to the deep guy. It isn't complicated. They're simplifying it and letting him play with his athleticism.
Third down and two. Tate, the lone running back, and Burns moves him to the other side. Burns will follow that way. Burns trying to scoot up toward the first down. He's going to be close. I think he's going to be a little short. What do you think about this, Eagle Eyes?
He's going to be a little bit short. I can see it from here. Definitely short.
And what do you do this time, Tommy Tuberville, who is?
First thing you do on defense, you call timeout. A minute and four left, unless you're content to go in down by seven, as West Virginia presently is.
Auburn's leaving its offense on the field right now. Perhaps that is factoring into the equation, too. You certainly don't want to stop it and have them convert.
Auburn isn't going for it. I'm going to tell you right now. I went to school to eat my lunch, but they aren't going to go for it. They're going to let the clock run down. West Virginia
called timeout.
Finally called timeout.
Now, Auburn does get the ball to start the second half, and assuming they can navigate these final 43 seconds, they'll be able to increase their lead. Now, my Hall of Fame running mate, one of them has, as a matter of fact, both of them, but one has national championship history with the Mountaineers.
Oh, I just threw the ball all the time. That's all I wanted to do. I never wanted to run it.
Where exactly was the pass to the tight end?
Oh, that was it. That was it. Tebow got that play from me.
34-21, the Fighting Irish won the national championship. You can see this year's edition of Notre Dame taking on Washington on ESPN2 Saturday night. And, of course, on ESPN, we'll have Alabama and Tennessee, the traditional third Saturday in October being played, and the fourth Saturday in October. And look at the last four Notre Dame coaches. We'll have Tyrone Willingham, who is now coaching Washington, and Charlie Weiss, who's the current coach, and Bob Davey will be in the broadcast booth for that game. I think you should probably chime in with something in halftime, maybe get a phoner with Jerry Faust, and we'll be all set up.
I'd love to, but we're going to be in the studio chained to the desk. If we weren't chained, I'd go.
Is that one of those deals where you call and ask for a ransom?
My wife wants that when she's going to get a ransom note.
Fourth down and one, and Durst will punt it away for the Tigers. High lazy kick, and that is not the typical Quentin Durst kick, who's averaging nearly 44 yards per punt. West Virginia will have a chance as we check in with Chris Fowler just before halftime.
Yeah, Reese, coming up on the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report, Craig and Jesse will join me. We'll talk about whether the championship chase is going to be shaken up this Saturday. Can Oak State go to Texas and pull the shocker? Is this finally the year Penn State wins in the Horseshoe, or will Terrell Pryor and the Buckeyes knock the Nittany Lions on the ranks of the unbeat? We're just seconds away from the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report.
All right, Chris, 33 to be precise, just outside the 33s where at Biden, the Mountaineers will take over. See if they can at least get in field goal range here before the half. White wanting to throw it, feeling a little pressure, and he's got his man out there. It's big 6'8 West Lyons, who makes the catch in Auburn territory and steps out of bounds in front of Walter McFadden. 26 seconds left. Now West Virginia has a couple of shots to, at the very least, perhaps get into Pat McAfee's range, which is pretty substantial. He has a 52-yarder this year. Not far away from McAfee's range now for a field goal. White to throw again. Buying a little time, and this one's going to be sailed out of bounds. About 15 seconds left in the half. As you see, that is Scooter Berry headed toward the West Virginia locker room to defensive end who hurt his knee during the first half, an important part of the Mountaineer defense.
When the quarterback scrambles, short receivers go deep, deep receivers come short, and normally you'll find somebody open. That's what you call an adjustment to a quarterback scramble. That didn't happen.
Well, if short receivers go deep and deep receivers go short, wouldn't they meet at the same point?
No. I'll explain it to you, Mark, when I get some chalk.
White just narrowly avoids a sack, and now he will not avoid it at all as big Zach Clayton was back there to wrap him up, and that's going to pretty much do it for West Virginia's opportunity to get on the board again just before halftime. What a quick strike from the Mountaineers, getting them back into Clayton, making sure that the Tigers suffer no further damage, and a couple of interceptions from White in the first half led to 10 Auburn points, and the Tigers have the lead on the road, and their head coach is with Aaron Andrews.
All right, Reese, thanks. Coach, you said to me before the game, all we need is some confidence. How are you able to establish that tonight on offense?
Well, neither defense is playing very good. Offensively, we've been able to run the ball pretty good. We set up a couple of bootlegs and a wheel route out of the backfield. You know, we're just kind of nitpicking. We're not doing anything fancy. We're just knocking them off the ball the first half. We're going to do a better job the second half.
Well, this is pretty fancy. 7-for-10 on third down. Why are you having so much luck?
Well, that's probably the best we've done all year long, maybe in the last three games. But, you know, the guys are getting more confidence. We're doing a little bit more of what we can do. We're being a little bit more conservative, but we'll probably have to open it up the second half.
Tommy, thanks. Guys.
Auburn has matched his season high for points in the first half, and as it has in every game, the Tigers lead at the break. It's 17-10. Let's check in with Chris Fowler, Pontiac Performance Halftime Report.
Oh, what a feeling. I'm feeling light.
But they're in a little bit of danger right now. They fake the end around. Oh, White throws it, and it's picked off. And again, White is picked off. Walter McFadden with the pick. They've got a screen set up with Lester. Lester's got a blocker in front. Brad Lester into the end zone. Touchdown, Auburn. Auburn, little bootleg. Burns has it. Burns did out running room. It's into the end zone. Touchdown, Tigers. White going deep. He's got a man. It's a touchdown, West Virginia. Ulrich Arnett and the Mountaineers answer. The most productive first half of the year for the Auburn offense. They matched their point total against Louisiana Monroe, but in that game, two non-offensive touchdowns. In this one, it's been the Tiger offense, which has finally come alive, perhaps for the first time this season. Reese Davis, my Hall of Fame running mates, Lou Holtz and Mark May here. So how do the Tigers keep it up in the second half and continue this impressive performance on the road?
They have to keep pounding the football. They have 29 rushing attempts in the first half for 100 yards, keep wearing out the West Virginia front seven, and continue to play error-free football. No turnovers by Auburn.
Yeah, and also they only have 1 5-yard penalty on offense. If you do that on offense, you can play that type of ball control. You have a penalty, it's going to be different. What West Virginia has to do is utilize the option. Here they are, they've run the ball 10 times, and that includes a lost yardage play for 97 yards. They're averaging 9.7 yards every time they run the football.
10 Auburn points coming off the two Pat White interceptions. West Virginia has actually outgained the Tigers by 10 yards, but Mario Fannin, who had a 69-yard kickoff return in the first half, is back along with Kristen Davis, and we're underway in the second half. And again, McAfee's kick is going to drive Davis into the end zone, and Auburn will take over at the 20-yard line. How about a look at tonight's coaching adjustments brought to you by the Home Depot?
Well, here you see the option. He comes in here, he comes out here, he pitches the ball. Nobody's out here in that area. Three options. He could hand it to the back runner. That way, quarterback can keep it or he can pitch it. And let's say this. West Virginia has two turnovers. That's wrong. They've had three. Auburn recovered an onside kick. That's the same as a turnover.
No, Auburn didn't cash that one in. They did cost the Mountaineers an opportunity to get the ball. Some time ran off the clock. That's an opportunity in field position. And Tuberville's Tigers, which have had a lead in every game this season at halftime, three times, falling short in the second half, trying to turn it around in this pivotal game for both teams. Brad Lester shakes one tackle in the backfield, and after JT Thomas missed him the first time, he went down and corralled him again. It'll be a loss of about a half yard.
Well, that's just a bad job by the offensive line. When you're pulling out there and you see opposite color, you block it. You don't let it run by you and hit the back in the backfield. You block the first thing that shows.
But the adjustment West Virginia made, they're going to attack that offense. You got to disrupt the rhythm, which is what happened on that play.
West Virginia defensive end Scooter Berry injured in the first half. We saw him limping to the locker room. been one of the standout players for the Mountaineers up front, so they'll have to try to slow down this rushing attack without him likely in the second half. Lester again and again, virtually nothing. Might have picked up a yard before Anthony Leonard and Chris Neal were there to stop him. And Leonard had a sensational first half. That his 12th tackle of the night. As you see Leonard trotting for the Mountaineer sideline. I'm going to leave him out there. He's been picking every tackle.
Yes, but, you know, the first half, Auburn ran north-south. Their first two plays, Mark, they've gone east-west for a total of about 8 inches per try.
In both plays, West Virginia got penetration on those runs.
7 of 10 on third down in the first half for the Tigers. Cody Burns throwing deep, looking for Tim Hawthorne, and Hawthorne caught it, but he was out of bounds, and Auburn will have to punt it away.
Boy, that looked good to me.
I thought he had the back foot down when he caught it. Let's have a little look.
Well, it's in front of the West Virginia bench. Let's take another look at it here. Great throw, a lot of air.
Nope, good call.
Good call. Great officials. Great officials. Great officiating.
Hawthorne very close. We see the back foot in the air, and that one has just a toe on the out-of-bounds line.
What a great start for West Virginia. They sent a message come out this half.
Forcing Auburn three and out. Ellis Langster will return the punt from Clinton Durst. And Durst has struggled in this game tonight. And the average kick, a big time block for Langster. Langster's put it on the ground. West Virginia, a very fortuitous turn of events for the Mountaineers as Boogie Allen was there to scoop it up and avert disaster for West Virginia. Well, Eric Smith, I think that's him shaking the cobwebs out.
Well, sometimes you just don't get the ball tucked away. When people run by you, it sort of distracts you. You lose your focus a little bit.
See, Langston missing it, and Smith was there to hit him to try to keep him from getting to it, but Allen was there.
Hey, just make a fair catch. Catch a ball, take it there, don't run the risk.
Is that what you told the Rocket?
No. Catch it, run.
Doc Sanders has the first carry in the second half for the Mountaineers, and he'll pick up about 5.
Nice run, just going north-south, coming back here. Now they'll fake that, they'll come back with the option. They can move the football against this Auburn defense, which is outstanding against the run, because you can't account for the quarterback, Mark.
First two drives for West Virginia. The first one was actually a successful drive, which ended in an interception in the red zone. Second drive, another quick pick. Since then, the Mountaineers have taken better care of the football. Noel Devine getting his first carry in the second half. He was stopped by Tez Doolittle and Sinderic Marks. Devine had 80 yards rushing in the first half, ripped off a couple of long ones, including a 36-yarder. Now it's West Virginia's turn to try to convert on third down. Only the second opportunity the Mountaineers have had on third down tonight. They're 0 for 1. White going to keep it, and White just had just enough to pick up the first down before he stopped by Chris Evans. Let's check in on the field with Aaron Andrews.
Reese, I spoke with head coach Bill Stewart on the way out from the locker room, and he agrees, of course, with Lou Holtz up there talking about our option is clicking right now. We ran the ball well in the second quarter, and he said the key to the success right now in the second half is Pat White running the ball. Guys, Scooter Berry, he has not come out from the locker room yet. They won't give me a final answer about what is going on, but I did hear from somebody on the sidelines it's not likely he'll return.
All right, Aaron, thank you. White's pass complete to Sanders. McFadden, the first one to hit him at about the 43-yard line.
I really like the way that West Virginia has changed the tempo of this game for their offense and defense. Come out of the locker room, stop Auburn in their first position, make them punt it away, get the ball, go down the field, first down, coach. They have the momentum now.
They've made some great adjustments, and if you're Auburn and you've led every game at the halftime, all of a sudden, here you go again.
Devine shifting to the left side, and White might just set up a little screen to Sanders, and he shot it right past him.
This was a play, Mark, where he could hand it to Devine or he could throw the bubble screen if it's open. It was wide open. Had he completed that pass, it would have been a major game.
All the success they've had on the ground, though, keep running the ball. I like an offense that when you start running the ball and have success, it gives you confidence.
When you throw an incompletion like that, as you mentioned, Mark, you get 7 yards on first down. Now you're third down and 3.
White 7 of 12 on the night. the native of Daphne, Alabama, standing in the pocket and throwing deep for Wes Lyons. And McFadden had tight coverage and a flag flying as Wes Lyons and McFadden were locked up.
This was a call that was well covered. I mean, you'll see the replay. He's bump and run. Notice how he backed up. Now he has leverage on him. Keep your hands off him and turn the ball, Mark, and it would never be completed.
Yeah, but I love the play call. I love the matchup. When you've got a guy that's 6'8" with long arms and can go after it, and you're covered by a defensive back at 6 foot.
Number 6 on the defense. Penalty 15 yards, automatic. First down.
It's always advantage for the offense when it's one-on-one. It's like basketball, getting the rebound.
I disagree with you completely. One-on-one ain't good enough. Two-on-one's an advantage. You got third down. Get a first down. I don't like to throw it where it's one-on-one.
You just don't like to throw it to tight ends, so those tall guys.
Hey, run up and hand it to him. Don't throw it to him. You lost your rhythm because you went to the passing game. Auburn cannot stop the option when it's executed properly by Pat White.
McFadden was vehemently disagreeing with the call, saying that he was entitled to his position, perhaps, and just going for the football, but
he played it well.
I was hinting at that perhaps that was a questionable flag from this SEC crew, but it bounces in West Virginia's favor, and they've got a first and 10 on the 28. White play action. White throwing for the deep outside, and oh, wide open out there was Jock Sanders, and he dropped it.
Coach, that's a perfect example of trying to run with it and score before you catch the ball. Fundamentally, catch the ball first.
This is a great throw. This is a great throw. You're going to see him out here. Great. Had to throw it right over that guy.
Oh, my. Oh, they're having a look at it in the stadium just as you are at home. And Sanders had it in his hand and couldn't put it away. Now they'll come back with the option, and White knocked down the 25 by Antonio Coleman, the defensive end. Pass rusher extraordinaire, playing the run effectively that time.
That was a fabulous job by Antonio Coleman of getting upfield, holding his ground, and making the one-on-one tackle on Pat White. Obviously, Pat White's a lot faster, but his quickness was what really gets him going in this option game.
Very well defended. Still a four-yard game, Mark. 3 times 4 is 12, which is more than 10, which is what you need for a first down.
But, Coach, they were 0-for-0 on first down, so they got no yards out of that.
White throwing to Lyons, who is again working on McFadden, and this time McFadden defends it. No flags flying. It'll be fourth down for the Mountaineers.
Why don't you go with a calculator? 3 times 4 is 12.
Hey,
10 rushes in the first half for 97 yards, 9.7
yards.
Hey,
if you're a coach, you don't have to be smart. All you have to do is count to 10. You need 10 yards, 3 tries to get it, possibly 4. That's all. 2 of the 3 passes they threw were incomplete. Picked up 1 run of 4.5 yards.
So you're telling us it's easy to be a coach.
Absolutely, it seems to be a coach.
Here is Pat McAfee from 42 yards out and the all-time leading scorer in West Virginia history. Puts 3 on the board for the Mountaineers. West Virginia draws closer with its first opportunity in the second half. It's 17-13 Auburn. Welcome back to ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by Applebee's. And oh, we got a barn burner shaping up here in Morgantown tonight. West Virginia just put another field goal on the board. Auburn, which has struggled all season on offense, has been most effective, at least through the first half tonight. The Tigers with a 17-13 lead and about to get the ball back for the second time here in the second half. During the break, Coach Holtz mentioned how West Virginia has been pounding these kickoffs into the end zone. Auburn's been starting on the 20. This time, Tristan Davis will bring it out. And Davis has an alley. Tristan Davis gets a block, and he's into West Virginia territory inside the 40-yard line. The second kickoff return of more than 60 yards against West Virginia tonight. This one going for 62.
Here you're going to see a replay once again, Mark. They come back here. They form the wedge. He starts up. Create the wedge. They do a great job of staying with their blocks.
Their special teams have been awesome. The onside kick, the 2 returns tonight. Tommy Tuberville has to be extremely pleased with his special teams thus far.
Well, in West Virginia, the guys kick the ball out of the end zone most of the time. They don't always cover it as hard.
Davis set an Auburn record against Arkansas with 182 return yards. Took one back in that game and almost And the kickoff return for the touchdown there, and field position flips, and Burns looked to throw it, pulled it down, and gets down to about the 36-yard line. Chris Neal, Doug Slavonic there to make the stop for Mountaineers defense. Defensive coordinator Jeff Castile in Tuberville. His team is involved in yet another nail biter. That's sort of been standard operating procedure for the Tigers this year, as they're looking at a second down play, trying to take advantage of a big play in special teams.
Two tight ends, two wideouts.
Then Tate in the backfield. Burns will adjust to the shotgun. They've had one delay of game penalty tonight as the play clock goes inside five. They get it off. It is Tate, and there is no running room whatsoever. Snowed under by the Mountaineers defense. Forced to the inside first by Quentin Andrews. Also got a little help from Hogan, and also Sidney Glover, who's had a huge night.
Here you're going to see they just get penetration up there. They're not allowed to get any movement at all whatsoever, Mark. And you can't get to the line of scrimmage. It's hard for the back to make a cut.
Third down and nine. And one of the differences we've seen in the early going in the second half for Auburn on third down as opposed to the first half, the length they've had to go on third down. Burns. Good protection. Burns throwing for Trotney, threw it right at his feet.
Auburn came out the first two series, they ran nothing but I. Then they came back, they get the shotgun, both the same result, no yardage.
Look at Tuberville getting in Cody Burns' face. Very displeased. Well, that last throw.
I know why he's upset. He had good protection by the offensive line, but West Virginia did a fabulous job of coverage down the field.
He had Trot over there. He had an opportunity to complete the pass.
Yeah, but it's easier to protect the passer when they only rush three men. And you can afford to only rush three when it's third and ten.
Well, Durst, who is a great walk-on story, almost gets his punt blocked by Morty Ivey, but the freshman gets it off, and again, it takes a tough bounce. Durst, who played his first organized football game, as you see a flag fly now at the end of this play this year, was discovered by Buddy Gardner, who's a golfer on the PGA Tour, played at Auburn, and told the coaches, you need to look at this guy. And he beat out an all-SEC caliber punter in Ryan Shoemaker. But Durst, who's had an all-conference kind of year so far, is not having an all-conference evening at the moment.
He was averaging 43.6 coming into the game. But kicking's like golf, Mark. You have good days, you have bad days.
Plus, the weather may have a factor in this. They're not used to practicing or playing in weather like this when it's below 45 degrees. It's something new to most of these players.
Not only that, the football is much harder, and it's harder to kick.
Well, the patrons here in gold in Morgantown becoming a little irate with the discussion on the field with the Zebras.
During the return, illegal block in the back, number 28 on the return team. Penalty be happy to get to the goal. First down.
These fans are tough because that's their first penalty.
It is indeed, but it backs the Mountaineers up, and we'll see if West Virginia can move it again when you come back. Back here in Morgantown, West Virginia about to take over from its own seven. They stopped Auburn after a long kickoff return by Tristan Davis. A block in the back penalty on the punt return. Move the Mountaineers back inside their own 10-yard line. That's a fitting hat for a night that is turning more and more chilly here in the mountains of West Virginia.
That's a Davy Crockett hat.
Yes, king of the wild frontier. Right now, Auburn has been king of the game to this point, but Noel Devine with another big run. That one enough for a first down. He stopped by Tez Doolittle, and Devine a little bit slow to get back to his feet.
Well, you got to compliment the offensive line, Mark. What a nice job of maintaining it.
And sliding down the line of scrimmage and doing a great job of pushing the defenders down the field. But I like the way that Noel Devine pressed the line of scrimmage, found his opening, and took advantage of it and picked up some nice yards.
And Devine's going to take a break. And Mark Rogers, the freshman from Lawndale, California, comes in. Devine has 96 yards on seven carries tonight. Just a very good Auburn rush defense. White throwing it out the flat. They run that screen again, and they complete it this time. Jock Sanders has it up close to the first down marker. There's a flag coming in late. Looked like a face mask.
That was the same play that we talked about, the option, either hand it or throw the bubble. They completed this one.
Gerard Powers, who's coming back from a hamstring injury, gets a face full of face mask as he tries to get Sanders to the ground. Be 15 more from Penn Wagers.
Personal foul, grasping the face mask, number 8 on the defense, 15 yards from the end of the run, first down.
Here's what I don't understand. If we were to look at that again, you would see that the ball carrier had his face mask as well. Both of them had their face mask, Mark. But a ball carrier is allowed to grab it.
You see Auburn struggles in the second half, as we've mentioned, in all three of the Tiger losses this year. They at some point in the game have held a double-digit lead, as they did once in this game. And now West Virginia has cut it to 4, and they have the ball. Moved from out of the shadow of their own goalpost. They're getting up close to midfield. Rodgers has it. Rodgers slips a tackle in the backfield. Mark Rodgers has a first down, running through Auburn defenders and getting down to the 42 before Chris Evans stops it.
This is one thing that head coach Tommy Tuberville and defensive coordinator Paul Rhodes did not want to happen. Make sure when you tackle somebody or you touch them, you bring them down. You've got to be the first guy to tackle them, because if they break through that tackle, it's going to be tough to bring them down because the West Virginia backs are so quick in the open field.
Pickup of 14 for Rodgers, who was in after Noel Devine was a little slow getting up in this Auburn defense. And just gives up 108 yards per game rushing. Been giving up some ground to the old Golden Blue tonight. Rush coming on White. He misses Bynes, but he will not miss the rest. Antonio Coleman, Chris Evans there to corral Pat White.
It was a defense where they're playing straight man coverage. You go see a replay. White has nowhere to go. What a great job they do of always having him corralled in here in the pocket.
Coach, you did a nice job in the blitz on that play. That's a good play for Paul Rhodes, the defensive coordinator, to dial up.
And a linebacker, Josh Bynes, was the one who circled around on the blitz. Sanders has the ball. Sanders is loose. Jack Sanders getting down close to the 30-yard line. Gerard Powers pushing him out of bounds. And Auburn, after a fine play on defense, gives up big yardage, and it'll be a manageable third down after the 15-yard run from Sanders.
Coach, this is what I just talked about. If you're a defender and you get your hands on that ball carrier, you find a way to bring him down.
Well, you have to, but let me tell you, he's only 5'8". He's hard to see.
He's
behind those big linemen. They can't find him, let alone tackle him. What a big play to be third and 18 and to pick up 16 yards.
Second and 18, and now the third and 2 as a result. Option. White. Hit quickly by Merrill Johnson, but not hit soon enough before he picks up a Mountaineer first down, and the Auburn defense on its heels a little.
Boy, does that help your confidence and your momentum and your mental state of mind when you have second down and 18 and you get a first down running the ball in 2 attempts.
Devine back into the game for the Mountaineers, who have a first and 10 from the Auburn 30. Again, the give to the running back, and Devine getting up close to 100 yards on the night. He's knocked down by Antonio Coleman. Coleman, a pass rusher extraordinary, told us this week that he had to be very careful when rushing Pat White, that he liked to just use a speed rush and run guys down from behind, but he knew that wasn't going to work against number 5, and he's done a good job of it tonight. They'll move Coleman now to the opposite side on second down. Bynes stepping up in the middle, showing blitz again. Each coordinator trying to get the other to show his hand before the play clock expires. Coming in, Rhodes send. Here comes Bynes up the middle. They pick it up. White throwing complete. He threw it just a little bit behind his receiver, Darrell Jala. And Jala had his 9th catch of the year, but just a hair off stride kept him from picking up the first down.
You know how difficult this is for a receiver running full speed across the field to reach back and catch a ball that's thrown with such high velocity and come down with the reception for the big play for the Mountaineers.
But if they run the football, they've not been held to less than 4 yards on almost any attempt when they're in the spread formation.
They're in the eye right now. This has been the problem for West Virginia. Third and short, it is Sanders who's pushing his way up in there, and it's been a problem all year, but it wasn't a problem there as Sanders went behind the freshman fullback, Ricky Tolbach, who is channeling his inner Owen Smith to try to give the Mountaineers a little attitude in the short yardage situations.
Owen Schmidt was a fullback that they had at West Virginia previously this year. And not only that, he was just so physical, mentally physical. And he was just tough. He got to the line of scrimmage, knocked guys down, pushed the pile, caught the ball in the backfield. He was Mr. Utility Man for this West Virginia offense.
You just saw the difference in the number of rushing touchdowns that West Virginia's had in the six games this season as opposed to the previous 32. Just five rushing touchdowns for the Mountaineers this year. They had four games last season where they had five or more. And this time they're trying to do it in the air. A strike on the slant. Again, it was White to Arnett. They hooked up for a touchdown, and West Virginia's on the doorstep.
Coach, this is absolutely perfect by the offense and execution. Great protection by the guys up front. But look at that one. He knows where he's going with the football.
Just a great throw. And the defensive line gave him the throwing lane to be able to complete it.
Down by four, West Virginia on the Auburn three. Devine's back in the backfield. Mountaineers trying to take the lead. Got the Tiger defense spread out. Vines coming on the blitz. White throwing again. Wide open man. Touchdown, West Virginia. It's Jawa.
What a great game, Mark.
17 unanswered points, and West Virginia has its first lead of the game.
It's just confusion in the backfield. Look, he's wide open. It's a little slide across the middle right there. And you've got to be able to find out where your man is if you're a defender.
Well, it's sort of a rub pattern by that we're referring to. The two receivers come so close, knowing that they're going to be playing man and hard time switching.
An 11-play, 93-yard drive, and West Virginia, deep in the third, has gone on top of Auburn again. Now the Tigers have to find a way to answer when you come back.
Football Primetime, brought to you by Nissan, passionate about performance and proud sponsor of the Heisman Trophy, and Wrangler, makers of Wrangler 5-star premium denim jeans.
You're taking a peek at the Mountaineers swim teams last night at the WVU Natatorium. Both the men and the women fell to Penn State. Things did not go well there, but here at Mountaineer Field, all of a sudden things are going along swimmingly for West Virginia. 17 straight points. They've finished off an 11-play, 93-yard drive as Pat White threw his second touchdown pass of the night, and West Virginia has its first lead of the evening, 20-17. Now Auburn. The chance to answer. Tigers been down this road several times, and Tristan Davis, who had a big kickoff return the last time he touched it, tries again, but this time he'll be stopped just over the 20-yard line. And as mentioned, the Tigers have been in this position seemingly every game this season. Their losses have just come by a hair against LSU in the waning moments. Jarrett Lee to Brandon LaFell, and Bayou Bengals and the Mad Hatter won it 26-21. 2 weeks later, Auburn blew a 13-0 lead against Vanderbilt in Nashville and fell to the Commodores by one. And then in their last game against Arkansas, who had really been struggling, Bobby Petrino's team came back for the 25-22 win. And now as Auburn takes over, getting deep in the third quarter, the question is, how will the Tigers be able to answer? Burns going to throw on first down, and he's got his man Rodriguez Smith. And Smith gets out close to the first down. And this is a pivotal game for the Tigers and the way things are going to play out for them the rest of the season.
Well, they need to find out a lot about their team and their character, because this is a team that's had the lead at halftime in every single game this year and has lost three of them. Now they're on a road in a hostile environment. If they fall to 4-4 here, look at the remaining schedule. Ole Miss is playing very well in the Houston Nut. And then at the bottom of the schedule, they've got their toughest game. So this is a team that may struggle to get to a bowl game if they don't find a way to win tonight.
Burns keeps it on the zone read option, gets up to about the 38-yard line. But conversely, Mark, if Auburn could answer the bell this time, this team has shown some talent. They've shown a little bit of an identity on offense tonight, perhaps for the first time this year. It could bode well for November for them.
It definitely could. Tommy Tuberville can build on that with his team saying, guys, this is how you finish a game on the road in a tough environment against a good football team.
Second and five, Brad Lester has it. Lester has stood up. Right at the 40, it'll bring up another third down for the Tigers.
And I think the criticism that Coach Tuberville did is totally unwarranted. Here's a guy who does not have anything but a winning record against every team in the SEC. He's beat Alabama six straight times. He's beat Georgia four times. He's beat Tennessee four straight times. He has beat more top 10 teams than anybody else. I mean, the guy's done a tremendous job.
How long have you been representing Coach Tuberville?
I tell you, you pay me. Hey, Mark, I represent coaches. I'm just pointing out that in coaching, we don't always look at the great things somebody's done, just what he's done now. I got news for people. New Rodney's dead. He ain't coming to coach Auburn.
Slamming up close to the line and trying to get a first down, and Auburn believes it's got enough for the first down. Big push up front by Tyrone Green. Pat Liebig there to make the stop, but not before the Tigers pick up the first down. You see Bill Stewart chagrin. And I want to go back to this Tommy Tuberville thing. In his press conference last week, he sort of shocked a lot of people by basically taking the podium and answering every rumor that was out there about him, whether it was about his health, his desire to recruit, whether it was about his competitive spirit, whether he had negotiated a contract buyout. He said he's been there for 10 years for Auburn, and he plans on being there for 10 more. And right now, he's locked up in a pretty good one. Tubbs showing a little bit of feistiness.
Let me tell you what, if he answered every rumor at that press conference, that conference must have lasted about 4 days.
Yeah, August 1.
Say, as my wife said, all rumors about me better be confined to the coaching profession. So you can have all the coaching rumors you want.
But Tommy said he went to church, and people were going up to him at church and, "Coach, are you feeling okay?" And you know, he finally had just had enough and said, "Enough already. I'm going to get rid of all of this. Let everybody know I'm just fine and ready to coach." Mario Fannin running it for the Tigers and getting up close to midfield. And Tuberville has been wildly successful there. But, you know, Tommy told us this week, he said, "Hey, you lose three games in the SEC by 9 points. You struggle on offense, have the coaching change that we had midseason. Things are going to get stirred up. That's life in the SEC."
And the internet doesn't help. They can print anything they want without signing their name.
Are you a member of Facebook or MySpace, Coach? You go on there and post those?
Hey, you got to be kidding me. Hey, I don't even know how to turn on a computer.
His handle on the internet's Dr. Lou. A nice throw from Burns to Tommy Trott. First down, Auburn to the 40.
And not only this, watch the quarterback, Cody Burns, on this play. He's oblivious to the rush. There's a defender coming in his face, and he just doesn't even see him coming. He stands tall in the pocket, fires the ball down the field to Tommy Trott, the tight end. Look at that. Defender goes right on by, doesn't even see him, doesn't care.
Was Anthony Leonard coming in, and Fannin almost whiffed on him, but he got just enough. They knocked the linebacker off balance and gave Burns the opportunity to find Trott. Eric Smith back in the backfield. It'll be a little boot. Burns eludes one rusher. He's got some running room. He's going to pull it down. Cody Burns inside the 30, and he hits the deck, but not before. Another first down for the Tigers.
Touchdown by Robert Sands.
That was a smart play by Cody Burns, the quarterback. Watch how he executes on his play. It's a naked boot. He comes out to the outside, but West Virginia hasn't defended extremely well. They have contained, but look at his quickness and athleticism on this.
Boy, it was a great fake. I want to tell you, they ought to come back and hand it to the tailback on the same play, because he would have still been running.
This is a very good answer from Auburn so far. Smith has it, and Smith, off his own play, has got nothing to the outside. Inside a half minute to go in the third quarter. And Cody Burns, you see, he talked to us about how much different his mindset is now that he's not looking over his shoulder at Chris Todd. And it certainly exemplified itself, particularly in completion percentage tonight.
I think also the fact that they have simplified the offense. It's not complicated, not as hard to read. We throw it off one man, the linebacker, the corner, whatever else the case may be, or else run it, and he's done that perfectly.
Where would you rather be than sitting on the couch checking out the fourth quarter from Morgantown tonight? A three-point game and a dandy coming up in the final 15 minutes when you come back. Welcome back to ESPN's College Football Prime Time, presented by Applebee's. What a fourth quarter we've got coming from Morgantown. Auburn once up 17-3, now down by three, but the Tigers on the move as we start the second quarter, or fourth quarter, I should say, with the second and 12. Cody Burns running to the left.
Cody Burns, the ball
and he's knocked down. Aaron Andrews is with us. Aaron, you staying warm down on the field?
Well, I'm trying. You know, I'm standing behind Auburn's defense over here trying to listen in on what Paul Rhodes has to say, and I'm trying to get my hands warm. Guys, guess what? Auburn's heaters turned off. Head coach Tommy Tuberville told the team, you're not getting these heaters turned on until I say so. Coach Tuberville, how warm in that coat over there. I should bring this up for Coach Holtz.
Amen. We got a use for it. Don't let that thing down if they ain't using it.
Hey, look, West Virginia heaters are burning bright. That guy apparently has been warmed up by something else.
Yeah.
Third and nine. Burns getting a little heat. Threw it behind. Tommy Trotter. It'll be fourth down. Burns getting some heavy pressure from the nose tackle, Chris Neal.
Well, when I lived in Ohio and born in West Virginia, we had to put antifreeze to keep it from freezing up. That's all he did, have low antifreeze.
Well, it's like Coach Tuberville's nice.
That's what the guy without the shirt had, too.
Yeah, no,
what I meant.
Too much antifreeze.
Of antifreeze.
But Coach Tuberville over there in the sidelines, you know, he's got the thick coat on and the gloves, and he's got the muffs on, because the ear muffs on, and he's over there saying, I'm not going to turn that heater on until I say so. But well, he's not cold. He's probably got four or five layers on under that jacket.
Wes Byram trying to tie the game up for Auburn. He made one from 19. This one will be from 44. He's 4 of 10 from this distance, and Byram cannot knock it through. And West Virginia turns Auburn away.
This was almost blocked. You're going to see a guy coming from the left side of your screen. Oh, so close.
Byram in his career, now 4 for 11. Of course, he had the memorable game-winning field goal against Florida. And further heartened by that turn of events, our friend in the body paint. You know, as we discovered on Friday night, these are Mayday's people, Coach. He's like the mayor of Morgantown.
It just makes you proud of our college educational system when you see this.
Well, you need the spirit. You don't want him sitting there in, you know, tweed jackets reading a science book tonight. White getting up across the 25. Gabe McKenzie in there applying some pressure for the Tigers and knocking them down. Bynes also in on the tackle for the Tigers.
I agree with you completely. And one thing I would say, there's nothing like college football. The spirit, the enthusiasm, the excitement. And let me just get back to Coach Tuberville. Woody Hayes was at Iowa. And they were getting beat. It was cold. He said, it's all mental state of mind. He went out in his short sleeve shirt. Ohio State came back and win. That's why never again did he wear anything but a short sleeve shirt, regardless of how cold it was.
Noel Devine slips a tackle. Devine across the 40. Devine into Auburn territory and riding a man on his back, Zach Etheridge. Saving Auburn from further disaster, and Devine with another big run against the Auburn defense, his second 36-yarder of the night.
I'm so impressed with Noel Devine. The reason why is because he never stops his feet moving. At 5'8", 170, he's so quick, slides through the hole, and right here finishes off the run with extra yardage at the end of the play, dragging a defender.
He was highly recruited coming out of Florida. They knew they had a great one when they got him.
He's an internet sensation as a high schooler. His past has been well documented. Devine lost both of his parents before he was 12 years of age. Tough upbringing in South Florida. He is already the father of three, but he has been exemplary on and off the field. Bill Stewart was telling us yesterday. In fact, they have developed a very close bond, and certainly he's helping the bond with his teammates with his performance tonight. 136 yards, Mountaineers by three. Chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues in Atlanta on ABC Sunday. Jimmy Johnson trying to make it two in a row, put a little distance between himself and the field. Championship contenders like Greg Biffle, Jeff Burton, Carl Edwards all on his heels. Coverage begins with NASCAR Countdown at 1 Eastern time on ABC.
Oh, but Reese, the margin is 149. The hunted is Jimmy Johnson. The closest in pursuit is Greg Biffle. But it all comes back to margin, Coach. No driver in the modern era has overcome a greater margin with four races to go and win the championship.
Yeah, but remember this. Biffle's gotten progressively better in the last three Atlanta races, finishing 41st, 22nd, and 4th, respectively. And in the spring, he had led it for 151 laps. So don't be surprised if he pulls the upset.
How do you do that?
Oh, I marvel at myself.
Devine has it again. We've been marveling at him as Josh Bynes stops him, but I honesty compels me to say that sounded strangely similar to the earlier time we did the promo. Almost as if you guys were reading off a card.
What I said is I'm amazed I could read that. That's what it is. I'm amazed. I was impressed the way you did that, but I noticed you didn't have any big words in yours.
I talked about the margin this time. The last time I talked about Jimmy Johnson's three victories.
Devine's got a crease. He made Stevens miss, but Stevens had help, Antonio Coleman, and Noel Devine stopped before he could rip off a truly big game and bring up a third down after the 6-yard carry for the sophomore from Fort Myers. We were talking about Devine's story a few minutes ago, and Bill Stewart talking about how they've developed a relationship over the last year or so where Devine stopped by the office a couple times a week just to talk about football or other things going on. It's been a good haven for Noel Devine to get out of the environment he was in and come here to Morgantown. It's been a mutually beneficial relationship. White on third down. White's got a man, and it's Jella. And Jella is loose and inside the 20 and still on his feet. Darrell Jella, touchdown West Virginia.
Here they come on a blitz. You're going to see the blitz coming in. They're playing man coverage, coming across there. Now watch the move here. Watch the quickness he has. A great move. Don't wrap his arm. Takes it into the end zone.
That's a fabulous job by Joe to finish the playoff. That's what I'm talking about. Running through tacklers, getting to the end zone, finding a way.
And at one time with a 17-3 lead, Auburn is in a world of trouble because the Mountaineer offense is alive. Darrell Jala off the pass from Pat White, and West Virginia has extended its lead to 10.
ESPN's College Football Primetime is presented by Applebee's. It's a whole new neighborhood. And in part by Lexus and their passionate pursuit of perfection.
Good solid looking intramural quarterback play, but I think that guy's no Pat White. Certainly not in the second half. White has been outstanding. His last two touchdown passes have gone to Darrell Jala, and West Virginia has opened a 27-17 lead. And look at the difference in the offensive output in the second half. West Virginia has just dominated, and they've outscored Auburn 17-0.
I don't know what head coach Bill Stewart told his team at halftime, but whatever it is, it was right on the money, and it worked. The changes that they made from the first half to the second half, taking over offensively, coach, has really paid off for West
Virginia.
Well,
the defense has really set the tempo.
A very short kickoff this time. It hits the ground, bouncing around. It's a free ball, and Auburn wisely gets on it in about the 24-yard line. It's where the Tigers will put it into play. College football on ABC continues Saturday night. Undefeated number 3 Penn State going into the horseshoe to take on the Buckeyes. Saturday night football presented by Southwest Airlines on ABC. And Penn State, major test, obviously. You see the veteran Darrell Clark. He's getting his first opportunity to run the team full-time against Terrell Pryor, who will be on a big stage on Saturday night.
And we'll see how he performs on the big stage. If he has a couple of turnovers, how will it affect him? Because this game has so many implications going to the Rose Bowl, possibly playing for a national championship. That's a lot of pressure for a young freshman.
He'll handle the pressure. I'm not worried at all about him, the way he'll do things.
Screen out to Ben Tate for the Tigers, and West Virginia has that sniffed out, and it'll gain nothing. Anthony Leonard, Sidney Glover again. Called Glover's name all night long.
West Virginia is just playing excellent football the second half. Coach Stewart's done a great job at halftime. Their defense is playing excellent football. They're tackling very well. Auburn is not tackling as well in the second half, Mark, as they did in the first.
You look at West Virginia, they've got the momentum, obviously, right now, but the enthusiasm, they're flying around having fun out there.
Tate from the carry on the right side. He'll be stopped for a short game. Mark, you talked about enthusiasm on Sunday night. West Virginia practice, and Bill Stewart had to stop practice because there were fights. At one point, there was a tie-up between the offensive tackle, Ryan Stanjic, and JT Thomas, which upended the defensive coordinator, Jeff Castile. I mean, they were getting after it to a point where Stewart said, I had to stop things to make sure nobody got hurt.
But you really want to see that as a head coach. Coach, don't you want to see the guys getting after it? Because that means they're excited about what they're doing.
I want to see him get after it on Saturday or Thursday night, not on Sunday at practice.
Well, they're doing it tonight. Burns almost sacked, stays on his feet, throws it into a crowd. He was looking for Robert Dunn, and Dunn hasn't had much of an opportunity tonight. We have a flag down on the play, and it's going to go against Auburn. Jack Cooper, Julian Miller, and putting pressure on Stewart, saying, let's decline that thing and get it back to a red-hot offense. Just 10 wages with the call.
Holding. Number 73 on the offense, penalty decline, fourth down.
Well, it looks like everything's going well for West Virginia right now, but as soon as the tackle turns his shoulders right there, he's got to drag the defender down.
Absolutely. If you don't keep your shoulders perpendicular to the line, to the quarterback, you're going to give up a sack.
You can't step in that bucket with your left foot if you're the left tackle.
Well, you can do it. You just can't do that and block him. But you can step that way.
That was Lee Zimba, who... the sophomore tackle has been terrific for Auburn, starting for 2 years, but he has been plagued by penalties this season, and he gets one there against the Tigers, but it was declined, but no results. Mountaineer is still going to get the ball back, and now Auburn is in desperate need of a stop, down 10 with just over 10 minutes to play. Let's take a look at the weekend menu presented by Applebee's, headlining Penn State and Ohio State among four matchups on Saturday between ranked teams. And Texas, it's just a weekly occurrence for the Longhorns to play somebody in the top 10, isn't it?
Yeah, they got somebody else on the roster there with Texas Tech coming up. I want to get five TV sets because I also want to see Alabama against Tennessee.
We have eight in the studio, so you should be covered.
Yeah, but you got all the answers. You and Mark May, I have no chance. You have all the answers.
White gives it off. He faked the pass. There was some supportive gear, perhaps, leaving left on the floor after Devine put a little shake in his move. Chris Evans makes the stop for the Tigers. A rather exciting 2-yard run, as only the former internet sensation can deliver.
Coach, you used to go on the internet and watch Noel Devine, didn't you? Dialed right in and used to watch it, download it, and, you know, burn it to a DVD and take it with you on your trips.
Put it on his iPod.
I got to tell you, I don't know how to work the internet, which is why I can't be president.
Oh, ball's on the ground, an opportunity for Auburn. Michael Goggins was trying to sneak in and get it. It was a big scramble on the pile, but West Virginia is going to retain possession.
This was caused by a high snap. It was a precision play. You're going to see the guy coming in motion right here. And the ball is high, so he can't get it down there in time. Doesn't make a real good thing. But see, the one guy was going for the ball. The other one's going for a scholarship.
Yeah, but how about Jock Saunders? Only 5'8", 185, taking the ball from Michael Goggins. 6'3", 260 pounds. That's a lot of strength. That's determination in wanting to get that football.
And now third down, and Auburn needs to stop. And West Virginia will go to the quarterback draw. And White is hit and slammed down after a pickup of two, so the Tigers will get it back. Craig Stevens on the stop.
This was a big stop for Auburn defense, but what they got to do now, they got to get a block punt, a punt return, something like that. They returned a punt this year for a touchdown, and I tell you, that was the first time they had done it in over 374 punts, 144 games. Last time they ran one back, Dunn, the returner, was 10 years old. Now he can vote.
Well, Dunn has been Slaughter. A little bit nicked up, and he is not back there right now. It's Chris Slaughter, and this is the first punt of the night for West Virginia. McAfee takes a little bit of that rugby run, and Slaughter fields it at his 25, and he'll get about 1.5, and that's going to do it. West Virginia with a 10-point lead, and time is starting to run short for the Tigers. Auburn has it when you come back. The artwork is admirable, if not totally accurate. West Virginia was actually a slight favorite in the game. We have had plenty of upsets this year on Thursday night college football primetime. We've got a good one going in Morgantown, but right now, Auburn in dire need of putting together a drive. They haven't done much since the first three times they've had the ball. In the last six drives, they punted five times and missed a field goal. Ben Tate has it. Tate looking for the corner. And Tate can't slip a tackle. Guess who? Sidney Glover again. Bring up a second and 10 for the Tigers. And Cody Burns has taken care of the football, managed the offense for Tommy Tuberville pretty efficiently, and they came out with long drives, controlled the ball in the first half, and 100 yards rushing in the first half, just 37 cents. Burns pulls it down. Burns gets up to about the 33-yard line, and it'll bring up a third down. Glover making the stop. Here in the first half, you see Auburn ran it for 100 yards. Lester got in on the act, Fannin too, Mark.
He did a tremendous job of getting the ball to the outside, and the offensive line running, pulling, and blocking, and getting blocks, allowing them to have some success running the ball in the first half, but the second half, not so much.
What adjustments have you seen from West Virginia defensively to stop this running game in the second half, Coach?
Well, they're blitzing more, they're controlling the line of scrimmage, and Auburn is not getting real particularly good play by their wide receivers, either blocking or catching.
And right on cue, Tim Hawthorne, a little hybrid wide receiver, tight end, had a couple of big catches in the LSU game, really could have used one there. He was defended by Nate Sowers. It's going to bring up another fourth down.
I mean, you another can't punt. Throw the ball any better than this. You just got to catch it. And on the first play of this series, where it was a no gain, if the receiver makes a block, Tate picks up 10 yards.
Quentin Durst has not had his customary fine night. There is Ellis Langster. Langster is a native of Whistler, Alabama. So he's playing his home state team as well. And the senior, that's more Durst-like, driving Langster inside his own 15. Langster put it on the ground, but bounced right back to him. He was able to make the stop. West Virginia with a 10-point lead. Let's do a Sports Center right now and check in with Steve Levy.
All right, RD, thank you. Lute Olson announced today he will retire as head coach, University of Arizona men's basketball team, effective immediately. A national search will begin shortly to find a permanent replacement. Associate head coach Mike Dunlap takes over on an interim basis. The Rays trying to even the World Series at a game apiece, have a 4-0 lead over the Phils as they go to the bottom of the sixth. SportsCenter coming up after the game, right after you're through in Morgantown, Reese.
All right, Lees, we'll look forward to it. And Fowler finding out what a grind it is on Thursday night in the studios.
Oh, I tell you, it is difficult. People have no idea how hard
it is. You know, when we start a Thursday, we finish it. Three of us. We finish.
One of us finishes it.
Well, at least one of us does.
Yeah.
That would be you.
A short game for Jock Sanders.
I thought we were a team.
We are a team.
Yeah. Hey, there's no I in team, but there's no we either.
See,
I love being in this college environment.
This is a terrific environment. Thursday nights have been very special for West Virginia, both at home and on the road. The give is to Devine again. Devine's going to reverse his field. Noel Devine's got some room, and he's got a blocker. Noel Devine inside Etheridge. He's still on his feet at the 40-yard line, and Noel Devine is putting on a show.
A terrific run by Noel Devine, but you're looking at a quarterback and Pat White that's coming back from injury, from a concussion, from a bad thumb. Watch him on this play. He's going to lead Noel Devine back on this play across the field and get a block down the field of play. Talk about leadership, Coach. That's it.
That's nicely done. That's one of those runs. Don't reverse your way to go. Nice job.
Averaging 13 yards a carry against one of the better rush defenses in the country. Devine over 170 yards tonight. He has been a stalwart in the West Virginia rushing attack. The offense has also gotten three touchdown passes from Pat White, the last two to Darrell Jolla, who has it again, and it's pushed out about another first down for the Mountaineers. Jock Sanders getting good block.
You have to be impressed with Pat White. Pat White's ability to throw the ball, quick relief, right on target. You're going to see a replay here. But also, I admire the quickness of the West Virginia receivers and how smart they are to set up the blocks and how they block to one another.
the staple of the West Virginia offense, which has totally revamped the passing game under new offensive coordinator Jeff Mullen. A lot more pre-snap reads, different things in technique that White is doing this year, but the screen has long been a staple of this attack, and they've run it effectively, scored a touchdown against Syracuse earlier this year. Devine has stopped for no gain.
If West Virginia can continue to play like this, particularly in the second half, and gain momentum from this, they'll definitely challenge for the Big East Championship. They'll be right there at the end. You're talking about teams right now, you're looking at Pittsburgh right now. They're the favorite. South Florida's right behind them. And West Virginia, if they can play like this, they're going to be right there at the end.
Well, this is the second straight game that the Auburn rush defense has had its struggles. Michael Smith of Arkansas had a huge night against the Tigers in their last game. Paul Rhodes and Tommy Tuberville in hopes that the time off will let the guys get their legs back, but they look like they're starting to wear down now as Jock Sanders gets the carry and picks up nine.
It seems like West Virginia now, coach, is imposing their will on the Auburn front seven. And here's the case. How does Auburn figure out how to finish games? Having the lead seven consecutive games this year and then blowing the lead at least three of those games, actually four of those games this year now.
And all three losses have been by 10 points. If they lose tonight, it'll be 10 points as well. But this is a West Virginia football team tonight that everybody expected when they picked them number eight in the country in preseason. The ability to run the ball, the ability to throw, the ability to play good defense.
They're down again. The Mountaineers keep it on the ground, and they pick up the first down. Devine going to be around 175 yards now. This on the heels of Michael Smith of Arkansas getting 176. And I think the question becomes, guys, as well as Auburn's defense played in the early going, yet they were constantly put under stress by the Auburn offense, has that started to take its toll?
Well, I think mentally, the fact that you're saying, here we go again, and when your offense cannot move the football, it does nothing to motivate your defense to come up with great plays. And I think it's just a combination of, here we go again. We couldn't score 10 points on this team if we played all night.
Devine met immediately on Mike Blanc. Tuberville watching that clock now as it has become the enemy as well.
From the times I've coached, what I always felt on the sideline, Mark, was if we could move the football, we were always in the game. But there were times if we couldn't move the football, you'd be down by 10 points in half and say, I don't think we'd come back unless we get a miracle.
Inside 3 minutes, the Tigers have all three of their timeouts remaining. They may need them, but Pat White playing against the team from his home state, trying to supply the knockout punch, and this might be it. Noel Devine into the end zone. Mike Dent, Ryan Stanchek, getting a block to finish off the 8-play, 89-yard drive.
What we're going to see is we're going to see a trap, so to speak, where it's a false direction once he breaks through the line and shot, Mike.
But a terrific job of pushing the lineman, creating a hole up front, and the offensive lineman pushing the defensive lineman, sealing it off on the backside, allowing Noel Devine to squeeze through the hole, and he was off to the races. They weren't going to catch him.
That just the sixth rushing touchdown of the season for the Mountaineers, but Devine has been simply that. It's a surname and an adjective in this case.
Just great evening for this young man who's very, very talented. And let's remember, West Virginia has now gone over 30 points. They're 57-1 with scoring 30 or more points. And I think it's safe to say they are looking very comfortable.
They wanted an answer to replace Steve Slayton. I think they found him for sure, and that's Noel Devine. Particularly the last game and this game, he's been fabulous.
I agree with you completely, Mark. This is a team that if they play like they did tonight, that you would have to say would be the favorite in the Big East.
Devine with a career night of 207 yards. He's coming on the heels of a 188-yard performance against Syracuse. They've kept Patrick White healthy. He's thrown the ball well after a very shaky start with a couple of picks. And they started to gash the Auburn defense, and now The Tigers down by three possessions and under 2.5 minutes to go, and it appears that Auburn is about to fall to 4-4 on the season.
Okay, Coach, let's test your math. 207 yards rushing tonight, 188 yards rushing in his last game. How many yards rushing is that in his last two games?
That's 395.
That's it.
I did go to fight, that's it. But here's the thing. Understand this. West Virginia also has three turnovers. The two interceptions plus the onside kick.
Very short kick taken by Mario Fannin. The Tigers have gotten a good kickoff return a couple of times tonight. They really could have used it there. And Fannin appears to be shaken up at about the 36-yard line. We'll check on him momentarily. College football on ABC, presented by Best Buy. Headlined by Oklahoma State and Texas. There's other regional action as well. 3:30 Eastern time as Colt McCoy and Texas trying to continue to pursue near offensive perfection. Mark, as you see them dealing with Fannin on the field, he was taken down on the kickoff. McCoy has played as efficiently as any quarterback you can remember in the passing game. He's completing over 80% of his passes.
Not only that, if you go back to last week, he completed 29 of 32 attempts, and one of those was a drop pass. And he has been absolutely spectacular the entire season. He gained the weight and the muscle in the offseason. It's really paid off for him. But he is so incredibly accurate with his throws, Coach, this year.
Well, he is. But what impresses me about Texas is the chemistry, the togetherness, and their complete football team. They run the ball. They throw the ball. Their defense plays outstanding. But they love one another. They care one another. You read the comments by their players. You have to be impressed. And that is the guy that makes you go. And that's why I think he's head and shoulders in the lead for the Heisman right now. But then again, we have five more games to go.
And when you play the way he has, people will pick you apart, as we did on College Football Final the other night and showed the three incompletions. Cody Burns racing for the sideline. He gets enough for the first down and steps out of bounds.
How does that happen? How do you have three incompletions?
Well, I
poor
tell
technique.
You, it's a great compliment to your receivers. Because most of the time, you'll have three drop passes a game.
Yeah, but they have everything gelling. The wide receivers, tight ends, offensive line, the running game now. They've got it to where it's almost perfected on offense, where they know they're going to score at least 40 points plus a game.
Zemba came out of his two-point stance a little quickly, and Auburn's going to back up five, I believe.
Prior to snap, false start, 73 on offense, penalty 5 yards. Darryl Maine first.
It is the left tackle, number 73.
No, no.
I knew it. It's just sort of contagious.
No.
The left tackle, number 73.
Well, the reason we bring that up, obviously, Mark wore number 73 in his time. Mark played a little left tackle in his day.
Oh,
I did. Mark had some button chops in his day.
Hey, no barbers in Pittsburgh.
Burns to throw it now. It's complete to Rodriguez Smith. Won't have enough for the first down, and the clock winds down toward 90 seconds to go. And it's been a roller coaster type of night and a frustrating one for Auburn and Cody Burns. West Virginia bounced back from a 17-3 hole to rip off 31 consecutive points, and the two-time reigning Alabama Amateur Athlete of the Year, Pat White, is going to get a victory against the team from his home state in his senior season here at West Virginia. But hey, he is revered in this state. And we kept trying to get Pat to talk about what it was like to face Auburn. And, you know, when his parents make the drive, as they often do for home games, almost every home game, they drive within a couple of miles of Auburn's campus on their way to Morgantown. But White wouldn't have anything to do with it. He basically said, my home's in West Virginia now. And certainly Mountaineer faithful glad of that. Burns getting pressured. Burns getting sacked. Zach Cooper, the junior back there, to knock down Cody Burns and put a little punctuation mark on this night for the Mountaineers. And the Wrangler five-star player of the game. Who else? Noel Devine.
And he's done everything for this team. Getting those tough yards in between the tackles, taking the ball to the outside, picking up the big plays, the explosion plays on offense, scoring touchdowns. Coach, he's done it all.
I think the offensive line deserves a lot of credit, too. Yes, Devine's done a great job, but that line's protected Pat White, gave Devine running room.
Likely be the last play of the game. Burns throws a jump ball, and it is picked off fittingly by the Alabama native Ellis Langster. A huge night for West Virginia, a pivotal win. And now Pat White's going to let some emotion out and celebrate as the Mountaineers take care of Auburn 34-17. Tommy Tuberville's team falls to 4-4, while West Virginia, remember those two losses, neither of them in Big East play, as you guys mentioned, still in line, perhaps contend for a conference championship and maybe another trip to a BCS game.
Well, this was a great environment. It was a great game. West Virginia played outstanding football.
And I think you can compare this, not as much, but if you go back to the Fiesta Bowl last year for Bill Stewart as head coach, this is a pretty good win for them. Going, okay, beating a team with a winning record from the SEC Conference, this is a very big win for Bill Stewart and his staff.
34-17, the Mountaineers get it done. Let's go down to Aaron Andrews, who's with the victorious head coach.
All right, Reese, thanks so much. Coach, first of all, a huge night for Noel Devine, actually a career night. Why was he able to pick up so many tough yards against his physical Auburn defense?
He's a strong little man, Aaron. He runs downhill. He runs behind his pads. It's just a tremendous effort on his part. I thought our offensive line helped him along the way, though.
And they also helped your quarterback, Pat White. And we also talked about with you what a big night this would be for him because he was playing against Auburn. The fact he's from Alabama. He's a quiet guy. What do you think a night like this means to him?
Well, it's very big. He's very powerful for Pat. He's the greatest winner in college football today, Aaron. And he's the greatest guy. He's an even better person. And we just told him to play within the framework of the offense. Don't try to do too much. And man, that's all. Just let him go and let five play. It was fun.
We heard how fired up your team was this week in practice, getting excused from practice. They wanted this win to get back on track. How does it help you now?
Well, it helps a bunch. We still, this is game seven. We're very blessed to be 5-2. We have five tough games left in the Big East. And I'll tell you, everyone's going to be a battle. Every week's a battle in the Big East. And we'll just have to take them one at a time, one at a time.
All right, Coach.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, thank you. Reese.
All right, Aaron, so happy Bill Stewart. His team outscored Auburn 24-0 in the second half. I called her Aaron, but we get to work with this crew one time, and Coach already has a pet name for her, calling her Irwin. I mean,
well, she said that real close friends could call her Irwin.
Okay. Is that the way it goes now? There are a lot of close friends here in Morgantown who are celebrating a victory that could resonate for the rest of the season. Really let the Mountaineers gain some momentum with a 34-17 victory over the Tigers. Don't forget, SportsCenter's coming up next. Over on ESPN News, it's the Post Game Extra. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Mark May, Lou Holtz, Aaron Andrews, and our entire ESPN crew, I'm Reese Davis. Good night from Morgantown, where they're singing Country Roads.